right. A very good evening to you right here on Joy 99.7 FM, your superstation, channel of blessing and your place of inspiration. Today is Sunday, the 18th of February, 2024. It's just a minute after the hour of nine. This is A Walk with Jesus. My name is Ato Acquah. I'm ably supported by way of production by Mikaela Nye. And if you're tuned in, I would encourage you to log on as well to Facebook and share the link for We're Live on Facebook as well. This month, we've been dealing with the subject of love and understanding the various aspects of love. But today, we're dealing with the subject of understanding personalities in relationships. Understanding personalities in relationships. Happiness in marriage is greatly dependent on how well each spouse understands their partner's temperament and how willing they are to meet their partner's temperament needs. Temperaments are very vital in helping individuals to identify careers that are most comfortable for them and also assist them in their spiritual growth. In fact, temperaments are the determining factors of what we are. And that is why it behooves on us to discover who we are, know the temperament category of others, especially our partners, in order to avoid assumptions and misunderstandings which normally characterize relationships. So tonight on A Walk with Jesus, we have our resourceful power couple, as you call them, right here to help us understand and ascertain how best we can know, how best we can have an understanding of our temperaments and have the correct knowledge to find balance in our lives and in the lives of our partners. We will appreciate it if you join us with your comments and questions via WhatsApp. The platform is 055-1111-997. That's 055-1111-997. And on the Joy FM Facebook page as well, we are live. So connect, share the link, share so that friends and loved ones will also get connected and be blessed. My name is Ato Acquah, and this is A Walk with Jesus. Stick and stay. We'll be right back after this musical break.
If I don't love you, I miss the mark. So it all comes down to love. Stephanie, come and join me on this one, wherever you are. Oh. Teach you the song. Come on, sing, sing it.
I said, oh, 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 it all comes down to love. Oh, 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 oh.
That's the only word. Let's sing it again now.
I said, oh, 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 it all comes down to love. Oh, oh, oh.
Michael, you can come join me on stage too. Listen. Said talking heads talking to us on the television. Silver screen preachers, politicians say they got the answers first. They want to squeeze us. Send a little money, what a tax on Jesus. Fix it with a prayer, fix it with a dollar. Anybody out there ever want to holler?
Oh, 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 it all comes down to love. Oh, 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 oh,
that's all I want to say is,
oh, 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 oh,
I can't hear. Self-help guru got a bestseller. Talk show host got a drag queen bank teller. 1-900, look into the crystal. DNRA says you better buy a pistol. Made a little pill, but it might cause cancer. Just a cheap thrill when looking for the answer. Now tell them the answer.
Whoa, 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 whoa.
the verse says. Suits on Wall Street, they make another million. Theater on the back street, talking to your children. You cry for help, nobody listens. You lay awake at night, wondering what's missing. Who can put an end to all the confusion? Open up your heart to the only solution. Oh, 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 oh. Remember it all comes down to love. Oh, oh, oh. Say it again, say it again, say it. Oh, 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 oh. It all comes down to love. Oh, oh, oh. Last verse. When I was Africa, I said, sing it up in Joburg, tell it in Soweto. Sing it in the gold mine and in the ghetto, the blood of Hector Peterson crying for apartheid. Tell it in Washington, the dream will not die. Bishop Desmond Tutu, Nelson Mandela, Martin Luther King, they only want to tell you. They only want to tell you. Oh, 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 oh. Thank you.
All right. So if you just tuned in, it's A Walk with Jesus right here on Joy 99.7 FM, your superstation, channel of blessing and your place of inspiration. And tonight, I call them the power couple. They're with me right here. Finally, after a long anticipation, you know, to have them with us, they're finally with us. And what are we discussing tonight? We're discussing understanding personalities in relationships. And I have with me here in the studios a couple I respect and revere so much and love dearly. And I count it a blessing to have them with us, and even as they help us to unravel this subject, you know, as far as our love lives is concerned. In the month of February, we are looking at the various possible areas to look at as far as our love lives are concerned or is concerned. So I have with me here, should I say hashtag or put asterisks, the power couple. And who are the power couple? Pastor Kojo and Mrs. Maureen Frimpong, right here in the studios of Joy 99.7 FM. Pastor Kojo has always been in the studios of Joy 99.7 FM, but then always. So let me first of all say a warm welcome to your dear wife and to Maureen. How are you doing?
I'm blessed, thank you, Pastor.
You are looking, I'm looking for a,
it's a personality.
Give me a word. It's a personality. In your pink and white.
Oh, you look I try. Good. Thank you very much.
Azofu.
Yes.
I don't know what prayers you went to pray.
Yeah.
But then I had meant to really bombard you.
I have a goal who never fails.
So it's God who has made my voice this way.
No. He's making it work for your good, you know.
Amen.
But how are you doing, so?
I'm good, my grace. How are you doing, too? How was church today?
Church was good, by God's grace.
We bless the Lord. We bless the Lord.
How was yours as well?
It was just a glorious time, you know. Glorious time in the presence of God.
It's good to be at the other end.
I know, right?
It's exciting to be at the other side.
It's exciting to be at the other side where you throw the jabs.
I'm looking forward to Tuesday, you know.
how do you feel when you listen to him treat me the way he treats me?
Oh, I think it's something
you pity
that...
me,
Do I? Not really.
Not really? Oh, really? I thought I was going to have someone who pity me.
No. I think it's helped us as Christians. You know, we rarely talk about these things, especially the things that you speak with Pastor Kojo. I think that it's a door that allows people to know that whatever you're going through is real.
Yeah.
But you have to work it, and God is with us.
Yeah.
And so if you would avail yourself and be truthful to yourself that these things happen to strengthen us and to make us better people in our relationships, then I think it's been helpful.
I see.
Yes. I realized that men need sex. That it is urgent. And so that Christian men need it. Yes.
Very.
Because sometimes somebody sits somewhere and thinks that I'm a pastor's wife, for instance. It's a holy thing. Mm. It's not holy to talk about these things in public, but you're helping other people who think that if a man is asking for sex 4 times in a week, for instance, then he's not spiritual.
Mm.
But it is a need and it's urgent. Wow. If you have the understanding, whoever you are, as long as you serve.
Not just urgent, but very,
it's very, very urgent. Yes. Yentun said that.
Debbie.
When it comes to sex, yes. So for such things, I think that when you talk about it that way.
Scooting scriptures to back it.
it's very important. So that it gives us in the faith that knowledge that it is something that cuts across. It's not just about your husband or your partner, but then it's something that is with a man. And as long as you have that relationship of marriage with them, it is your responsibility to make sure that these things are not things that we hide around, but we're excellent in it.
Interesting. Interesting. Well, let's come to today's subject. Talking about temperament. We've heard this word temperament. It's been used at various it's been used at different times in our conversations as people, you know. Help us. What is it, this whole thing called temperament?
I think that a temperament, Pastor Ato, is basically how people express themselves, who they are, and then their disposition. So when we talk about temperament, we know that it's been said that there are 4 main temperaments. And this is, we have extroverts and then introverts. And with this extroverts, you have the sanguine and the choleric. And then with the introverts, you have the melancholic and the phlegmatic. I hear supine a lot, but we don't use it because I think it's a mixture of all of the 4.
I see.
But would like to, for the reason of this meeting, would like to stay with the 4.
Stay with the 4.
The 4 is, I would say that it is compressing and expressing. So the extrovert expresses and the introvert compresses.
Which one are you?
I am an introvert, but I'm an extroverted introvert.
Oh, okay.
Because of my, where I grew up, my parents.
Social factors.
Yes, my husband, I have to be an extrovert.
I knew that had to be a major factor.
Yeah, so your upbringing, where you've lived, the kind of upbringing you had. So I had parents, my father was he was a pivot to my growing up. And so he was an extroverted introvert. So he is sociable because he was a leader. But in the house, he prefers that we're all one family. We're very courteous. We're very orderly in that manner. So I could say he's melancholic. So I have that because of upbringing.
I see.
And I am melancholic.
Are we born with it?
I think yes, we are. Okay. But then the environment could change it.
Right. Yes. But could you... is it necessary to consider temperament in choosing a partner to marry? And even if one is already married before is hearing us talk about this, is it important to consider temperament as a factor in dealing with one's spouse?
Okay, so thank you once again. Let me pick it from before you marry.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so do you have to consider the temperament?
Yes, before.
Because basically, you are marrying temperament.
You are marrying
temperament. Yes, you are marrying the temperament because the temperament affects the behavior. Okay, it's more like the behavioral pattern that the person exhibits. So when you are getting married, you are marrying a human being, you are marrying a woman or a man, but you are marrying the temperament of the person. So like Maureen said, maybe you are marrying a choleric, or you are marrying a sanguine, or you are marrying a mixture of a sanguine choleric or a melancholy phlegmatic.
Which one are you? I asked her what she is. Which one are you?
Dominantly choleric, underneath sanguine.
She explained why she is, an extroverted.
So mine is, I think.
That's my
character.
That's your character.
So let me say that's my nature.
Okay. Because your father appears as a very calm,
cool, choleric person. I think from my mom. Yes, my dad is quite, my mom is quite strong, very aggressive.
I see.
The thing must be done. It must be done now. You know, because, if my mom and my dad are going somewhere, my mom will end up, you know, driving my dad, that we're getting late. Exactly. In this case, I would end up driving my wife, that we're getting late.
You it depends on the interest. The drive depends. The drive comes here with interest.
I see.
So, Pazato, when you're getting married, you are marrying temperament. Yeah. That is the reality. Okay, you are marrying the personality which is at play. And most of the time, you know, temperament is what attracts you to the person.
Oh, okay.
Especially when you are close to the person and the person is your friend. If you don't know and you get married, you can study. Okay, you can learn to understand who you are married to, and that will also enable you to be able to optimize the relationship
and
to get the best out of it.
I see. Yeah. I want you to take us through the four, you know, so that we have an idea.
Yeah.
Some of us have heard just the names: sanguine, choleric, melancholic, phlegmatic.
We
don't really know who. You know, so take us. I'm going to give you a bit of time to take us through them. I don't know which one you would want to start with.
I'd like to start with the choleric because
your husband is.
Yes. So because my husband is choleric, we'll start. So the choleric temperament is represented by fire.
Okay.
So they are the very brash people. Now, result, not very humane. And then you have the sanguine, impulsive, who wants now the life of the party. If it's not me, it's not happening. They're very sociable. They're very impulsive. You can't trust them.
Really?
Oh, yes. When I say you can't trust, it's so because they're impulsive. They're people pleasers. That's the truth. And so in that part of their mind, what they're trying to do is that I want to make them happy. It sounds good, but if you're with an introvert, because they analyze more, they want to know the motive. But a sanguine is impulsive to say, this is what is needed now, and we're doing it now. And so people will be happy. So because when you're with an introvert, they're saying that, no, let's analyze
that
this.
It paints a picture of a loud person. Huh?
Very loud, yes. They're sociable. They're the life of the party. When they come, hey, how is everybody doing? Hey, hey, hey. You know,
Easy to notice them.
And they're not very, how would I say it? They don't know how to keep their time. No, they are. They can be, depending on where they grew up from and their predominant temperament.
Okay.
So a sanguine can be shaped into looking like a melancholic if they're brought up by a melancholic parent.
Okay.
So it really depends. But a sanguine is always the life of the party, impulsive person who makes a decision before they think about it. And so the sanguine is very likable. But when you're dealing with them and you're not serious, you can't get anywhere with them. So for the public, the sanguine is, wow, we're happy, we're going on. But anything apart from what makes people happy, the sanguine becomes a bit bored if they're not in the center of anything.
I see.
Yeah, so the melancholic is one who is loyal, who is very analytical, very creative, quite moody, quite melancholic. They're very, you know, to themselves. They think deeply into things. They're not easily given to the pressure of people. They want to think about it before they act. And then the phlegmatic is like a phlegm. So they're very quite slow, permissive, passive people. It's okay, but they can be stubborn. You know, a lot of times people look at cholerics and say, oh, they're this, but phlegmatics is one temperament that people rarely talk about because they look quiet. They're very adaptable. But one of their weaknesses that can really shock people who chose them because they're permissive is their stubbornness.
I see.
Yeah, so.
With the mention of weakness, let's look at their strengths and weaknesses.
Okay.
You started from the
choleric. So the choleric is one who is a go-getter. He is
positive,
the positive, the result oriented. But when you talk about the negative, they're very brash. They don't consider people's emotions.
They just give it to you.
Oh, in the early times, now I can say growth has come. And so, yes, I mean, past has evolved over the years. So it's changed.
No, you confessed already.
Oh, yes. I listened to it. Yeah, but it was very, I mean, sometimes I just look at him, are you born again?
I am.
So honest, I'm just like, no, apart from everything. So when early in the early times of our marriage, I just sit down and say, Lord, I pray for this man. And I felt like I was the pastor now, because on the ground, everything has to be result oriented.
You had a soul to disciple, seriously.
You know, he was a strong person, likable out there. But when we come home, the harsh words are on you. Mm. He's cutting you with his words. He wants it now. If it's not working, you have to make it work. If it's not working, I'm right, you're wrong. Mm. And it's that way. And so you're sitting back and saying,
I don't lose arguments.
No, never, no. Never. It's never happened.
Oh, really?
So you just have to say yes. So I always say, you know what? Yes, it's yes. Right. So when you're even wrong, you have to apologize. He's wrong, but I have to apologize. Hey,
Jesus is wrong, but I'm sorry.
Yes. So it's beautiful now that we're talking about it, but the process was a learning hard. When I say it was hard for me, because I'm just wondering, you're supposed to know that the scriptures say, be kind-hearted, mm-hmm. speak with, let you whatever you say, edify the hearer. Mm-hmm. This is me. Yes, this is me, the melancholic, trying to analyze the word of God and trying to walk into it. And this is my choleric preacher husband, who I just finished preaching and said, Jesus loves you, and comes back and say, we'll be here. And I'm just like, who is he talking to? I thought Jesus is love. But for him, because he has not gotten that goal, he's not reached that goal, whatever Jesus is saying, it's not happening.
I see.
Yes, but we had to grow out of it. Because then I realized, it took me about 5 years to realize it was a sanguine on top of the choleric, Jesus Lord.
Wow.
So I had to make that decision to say that this is who I've married. How do I manage it?
Two opposite sides of the coin.
We're like north and south.
Yes.
But we're in the middle of the sea and we're swimming.
That's interesting. It so is. How do you make it work since you are direct opposites of each other?
For me, I think that with the help of the Holy Spirit and making an effort to understand that this is the person I'm married to, the complaint would come, but it wouldn't change anything. Mm. And sometimes, like Peter says, that if you are of good behavior, it could even change your unbelieving husband. Mm. Yeah. My pastor husband has become the unbelieving husband. Yeah. So I think that the word of God was my guide. Mm. It was difficult. I mean, it is difficult. It's because the person has not changed entirely. Mm. So as it is difficult for me and him, it's also difficult for him dealing with me sometimes, I guess, because I think I'm prim and proper. I'm thinking, I'm considering, all of it is, you know, we're perfectionists. Yes. And we're thinking that everything we do is perfect. But he thinks that, no, it has to be done at this time. I'm saying, have you considered? Mm. Because we don't like to second guess.
Exactly.
Or have to damage control. Mm. The melancholic is not built that way. Mm. So if something goes wrong and he says, I can't do anything about it because I want to get it right the first time.
I see.
But he can go because he's sanguine and say, oh, it's okay, we're wrong, yes, let's go. But I'm saying, no, I can't be doing that every time with you. I want to make sure that what we're talking about, what we're planning, is well planned, and we would avoid a lot of the, you know, oh, is it bad? Is no. We plan it such that it's perfect, but it delays.
I see.
It means that
when it's the other way around, where the, like the case of his, I think I should throw the question to you, like the case of your parents, you know, where is the woman who rather has your character?
Yes.
How does one put up with it?
No, I think that basically the culture, the society, okay, because in the society we assume the man is supposed to be the leader,
mm-hmm.
okay, but like Choma said, the choleric has leadership traits because of the drive, because of the passion, you know, because of the enthusiasm, you know. So when your wife is a choleric and the man is a melancholy, then it means that the table is turned. Mm-hmm. So you find the woman driving the family.
Does that mean the woman becomes the leader?
Not necessarily. Then. The woman is just exhibiting her strength.
So for those who say, oh, my, you're a shell, so.
There's a way the man is. Because if the woman does not exhibit that strength, the family will go nowhere. So you will notice that even the melancholy husband will testify to the strength of the husband. If your husband is phlegmatic, like she said, very slow in making a decision, quite slumber, you know, in a state of, you know, as if he's asleep, you notice that the woman will be driving him you know.
See the choice of words. You were saying you would want to consider.
Yeah.
But he's seeing it as you are slow.
Yes. Exactly. Expressing. You know, I'm compressing. Ato,
for exactly. The choleric woman, yes. I mean, she sees that character or that temperament of the husband being a phlegmatic as being slow. Are you getting the point? So I would, within a split of a second, I've made a decision. My wife would
take time.
I mean, 3 days. I mean, okay, so if this doesn't
happen. Because I'm building a tower.
You know, but for me, I mean, 1, 2, 3, we're good to go. If it doesn't work, I'm like, you know what? It didn't work. Let's just look at another option.
And that tires me.
Exactly. But because of her temperament, it doesn't also work well with her. Also, you get understand. So for me, the critical thing is that the reason I got attracted to my wife was because of this same temperament issue.
Oh.
That she would end up complaining in the process of time. And the reason why she also got attracted to me was because of my temperament.
Yes.
Which would also end up complaining. You know, the positive side, she will gladly talk about it. The negative side, she will also complain about it. You understand?
Exactly.
So basically, I think that
it all boils down to understanding.
And then, for me, that is the key. And you know, understanding doesn't come overnight.
Yeah.
And you don't discover the complete temperament of your spouse overnight. In the process of the relationship, it is ongoing. You will begin to appreciate and understand who you are married to and how you respond to the character or the temperament of the person.
Interesting. Let's come back to school.
Yes.
So we've gotten to know the sanguine, we've gotten to know the choleric. Now let's look at the melancholic.
Okay.
What are the positives? And
okay, so the melancholic is negatives. A loyal friend.
Mm-hmm.
They're very analytical. They're perfectionist, and they're very creative people.
Mm.
And the phlegmatic is one who is very adaptable. Mm. So if you're married to a choleric, somebody will say, "Oh, nirene mpekasa, ompenupa." No, that's for the melancholic. Ompenupa. The phlegmatic is, "Oh, baby, obekambi, I love my wife that way." That is because you're a choleric and you always want somebody to accept what you're saying. So the phlegmatic responds to, they adapt to what you have given them to do. And then the choleric, on the other hand, reacts to what he has actually accepted. So if you're not careful, the melancholic and the phlegmatic married to an extrovert always get to that place where there's a bit of a confusion. Because these, the two people, that's the melancholic and the phlegmatic, have one thing that is adaptability. So I may not be quiet, but because my husband expects me to be quiet, I can carry it very well.
Okay.
So they are very loyal. What you expect me to do, that's what I'm doing. I want him to be happy. He's happy. Even though I'm sad, I'm happy. You compress. But the phlegmatic is a bit stubborn. So he would say yes. But you go away, they do what they want to do.
Whoa.
Yes. So they say, you act like you're quiet. People think you're quiet, but you're not really quiet. You're very stubborn. We spoke about this, and you went on to do what you felt like doing.
I used to get that because I'm a phlegmatic.
Yes. Okay. So he's looking at you like so that. Yeah.
You act like a very quiet person, but you are stubborn.
You are stubborn. Very stubborn. That's what I'm saying. That's one
and
part.
Because she lives with you.
She's the best person to say, yeah.
So I don't live with you. So I would say that Pastor Ato is very quiet. Very quiet.
Because it's adaptable.
But your wife is a way.
Yeah, you say, just like you've done. He said, okay, it's fine.
Mm-hmm.
But they're going and like, I'm not going to do
way,
it.
Yeah.
And he's phlegmatic about, I would not do it.
Yeah.
So you pull him, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. But everybody's, oh, but your husband is very calm. I wish I had that kind of a husband. But we've planned something. He would not finish because he has not understood what your plan is going to get us to. And because of the phlegmatic part, he needs to be, you need to draw it out of him. And that's why, where if you're married to a choleric wife, she has to draw it. And for you, the phlegmatic husband, you have to understand that she needs to draw the phlegm out of you. You know, sometimes when we talk about understanding, we make it look like it's a strong person who should be at that side where we're winning. But sometimes the temperament that looks like it's weak It's very difficult to deal with because now, let's say you're a phlegmatic husband, your wife is choleric. You need that strength to pull the phlegm out of you. So their phlegmatic husband has to sit down in a place of allowing the Holy Spirit or yielding his members to, this is the woman you've given to me. Obviously, she's not like me, but what she's doing is for our common good. Even though she doesn't have my style or she doesn't do things the way I do things, it is for our common good. But when the phlegmatic is in a society where they say, oh, you're a bear man, show that you're a man. Mm-hmm. And now he's carried, that thing has eaten up in him. He's not going to do it. Yes. Not because he doesn't believe in it, because he feels that people think I'm weak. I'm going to show them I'm not weak. Mm-hmm. You're not weak. That's your personality. You have a phlegm and it has to be drawn out of you.
How will it look like when you have like temperaments getting married, you know, phlegmatic, phlegmatic, melancholic.
Does that really happen?
Oh, it does. When it happens,
is that heaven on earth?
It's not. It's quite. It may be boring. Like I said, sometimes society brings on you some kind of ideas that helps that kind of temperament. So if we're all introverted, but we understand that marriage is for fun. Marriage is for us to build a future. It says, the Bible says that which of you considering to build a tower does not first consider if they'll be able to finish. So I guess you went through premarital counseling. You went through all of that. So I know I'm melancholic. If I'm married to my husband who is also melancholic, it doesn't come. I don't think our temperaments show up the same time. Mm-hmm. So maybe like this afternoon we got home. I think my husband has had a call. And it just changes mood. My melancholic self will be quiet, withdrawn, just move away from him and then speak to him later. If I were a choleric, like a relative I have, there's no discretion.
Which relative are you talking about?
I have a lot of them. But the person will just say there and there, and then they may have some kind of friction. But because I'm melancholic, I'm just considering that the person is not in the. I have seen, because I'm analytical, I have seen that a person has received a call that has spoiled his mood. So I will move away. I will analyze the situation, you know. Mm. But a choleric like him will just flare up. I will just go home and you change your face all of a sudden. Mm. What's that? You always do that. Because we need to know why you've changed your face. But I am thinking about the person's emotion more than the result I will gain from why did he just lose himself and everything has gone black. Mm. So when the two temperaments are the same, it's very important that we have a an understanding that there is an aim. Mm-hmm. And in that aim, it's not for one to win or one to lose. Mm-hmm. It's for us to win. And so we can be boring. Mm-hmm. We can be too creative. And then now we begin to hibernate.
Yeah.
You know, too many creative. Exactly. Yes. We begin to hibernate. So if we don't have anybody to speak to us or we don't learn, we don't give ourselves to learning, it gets to a point where the whole thing plateaus. Mm. And that's when you see that I'm bored with my wife or my husband. I'm not interested in the marriage anymore. There's nothing in it because you have the same temperament, especially if it's introverted. It happens to, I think, the extroverts as well, because they get to a point where they're flying, they're all flying. Who feels important if we're all sanguine?
Mm.
But in our relationship, my husband feels very important. Because that is what he loves.
But I've seen two extroverts marry, and they do so well.
They've learned it.
They've had their challenging seasons, but then they do so well.
Like you said, they've had.
They've had it. So they've learned.
They've learned to understand.
Yeah.
Yes.
For me, that is the key.
Yeah.
The key is basically allowing yourself to grow.
Mm.
Yeah.
You know, especially for us Christians, believers, we allow ourselves to grow into the fullness of God's image.
Mm.
So that we can exhibit that character.
Mm.
You know, so, you know, you are a sanguine, you are a melancholy, you are a phlegmatic, you are a choleric. That is basically your natural disposition. Mm. That's who you were born with.
Mm.
The environment you grew up also added to it.
Mm.
Sometimes the friends you had, the community you lived in, sometimes the school you went to, the people you met, all these things pile up and they form up your personality.
Yeah.
So once you come into Christ, and you begin to grow by the word of God and by your relationship with the Spirit of God, you take on that image. So even though you are a choleric, you are exhibiting that temperament in a certain space, which is guided.
So it becomes a spirit-filled temperament.
Exactly. Yes, that's.
But does temperament change?
Does temperament change?
Yes. You know,
somebody sent us, I just read a message.
A message, huh?
That he doesn't subscribe to temperament. Mm. So he even sending that message tells us that temperament.
He's melancholic. He's melancholic.
Are you getting it? Exactly. Yeah. So you may not accept it, but it's reality.
That
it's
even there. What you're doing shows who
shows
you are.
That shows you know this is yeah. who you are. You know, so Pasatu, temperaments change. Okay, I think I have learned to understand my wife more.
Mm.
So what I would have complained about, you know, like this evening, let me cite an example. Mm-hmm. So I'm done.
I like the look on her face.
Yes, yes. I'm done. So I'm in the car, you know, and then I'm waiting.
Mm.
My natural self. So you don't know we're supposed to get there before 9.
Mm.
And then the kids are with their mom and they're like, hey, daddy hasn't blown the horn. Just when they said it, then the horn went.
So,
and I realized that when my wife came, her natural self, she also didn't complain.
Yeah.
Because before she would have said, into the DBR, but.
Yes.
So it means that both of us are growing.
Yeah. Mm.
So she understands that, oh, Joe waited for me quite long. Is that not so?
Yeah.
And now she also realizes that, oh, before, once he entered the car, he would have
spun the car, horn.
Opened the gate, and then you know that he's on the move. Mm. You know, so temperaments change.
I see.
They change, especially for us Christians. Mm. By us feeding, meditating, and acting and doing the word of God. That is one of the things that changes our temperament. And basically it changes for us to align with God.
So more like modifying.
So with what you're saying, my understanding is that the change here does not necessarily mean that from a melancholic you change into a sanguine.
No.
But then if you're a melancholic, you become a better version of yourself.
Exactly.
If you're a choleric, you become a better version
of yourself. You're modified who you are.
Okay.
So what I wanted to add to what Pastor Kojo was saying was more of where people are in their temperament. We may look at it that I got married a very, I'm 100% melancholic, let's say. And then now we're trying to know one another. What we have to understand is that the Spirit of God talks about fear, anxiety, be anxious for nothing. This is a message for me directly as a melancholic. When he said, do not be afraid, do not be dismayed, I am with you. I would hold you and uphold you with my righteous hand. That is for a phlegmatic, because they're always afraid that people will leave them. For a choleric, guard your tongue. It's so powerful that it rules the whole body. So that change is you're modifying yourself to suit what God expects you. But the goal-oriented choleric should not change. But whilst now he's going to consider people that whatever word you speak, it should edify the hearer
and impart grace.
Yeah. For the melancholic, do not think that every hand is it's not the same.
Yeah.
So we're all unique as God has given us grace. So don't think that because we always expect people to behave in a certain way, we're always drawn towards good behavior. So I can meet you and your disposition can make me just say that this person is not serious. It may not be so, but over the years Pastor have taught me that people don't have that upbringing, they just are not courteous. I see it as it's uncouth that you see people and don't acknowledge them. But he would say, no, be a while. But for me, in my melancholic mind, why are you not conscious of your environment? When you see people, you acknowledge. But over the years, because he is sanguine and quite people-oriented, he understands that people need time to know certain things. I think that you were born into a society, like I asked him last week, how is it that you're born and you're 32 and you don't know you have to greet when you meet people?
Ouch.
But for pastor, he would accept it and say, that's fine. Different. And I'm just wondering, if you don't greet, then it means they're unconscious. I don't want to deal with unconscious people. I want people who are, that's me, melancholic talking. But when I consider as a Christian, I'm thinking, consider one another, be kind, tender hearted. But it also doesn't mean that the sanguine was perfect in the way they're saying that, he's not changed in a certain way. But what we're trying to say is that as much as we're doing it, if you lose yourself or your person, then who are you? But what we do is that we modify to become. And in that marriage relationship, if my husband is saying something, I'll just compress and listen to him. But I realized it wasn't helping the relationship, so I was avoiding him. I wasn't open to speak to him. But I was brought up to write, for instance. and to speak my mind. Mm. So my father would say, Choma, why don't you say what you're thinking? And we're in the house and nobody knows what you're thinking. So as a young lady growing up, I was taught to talk. Even though I'm melancholic, in my culture, you have to say what is bothering you. But I come to a culture where young kasa, silence is golden. And the silence is killing me. Though I'm melancholic, I was brought up by a father who would always expect me to say what I'm thinking so that he knows how to deal with it. So I'd write notes to my husband. The way you spoke to me today, I didn't like it. I think we should find a way to be catchers one to another. Oh, but the silence is now. I'm just like, is he born again?
That sure has to come to
me. Yes. You know? But then I sit back and say, okay, he's also from a world where... You don't talk what you're feeling. Mm. You say what is expected of you. And I'm from a culture where you have to say what you're feeling so that you can get results. Mm. So now how do we do that?
Mm. At the point I stopped reading.
So sometimes reading I can send a text and it's like, Simon Ochona, I don't read it all. So I'm just looking at, does he care about me? But it's not about caring. He's not able to put himself together to adapt to this person. Mm. But we had to do it and do it. And now... I talk more.
Yes.
But
when was the last time you wrote a letter?
Oh, yes.
And he's missed it actually.
He's missed it.
Yes. And I said I won't draw shit. But so I used to write a lot. If you know the last time you were talking on air on Thursday about women do not advance, I sent a text. I said, Joe, we do advance, but because we listen, we want to hear you ask us for sex, for instance. Mm. But we're
actually going to... You are being prophetic. We're actually going to go to temperaments and sex.
And that, so, for instance, I would not tell him...
Is it part of the discussion?
No, we have to.
What I'm trying to say is that he may ask, but I would do, because I know he's affected by his eyes.
Yeah.
So I would wear. I would not say, oh, Joe, no. I used to text him, oh, maybe I'm at work. Mm. And I saw tonight, we write something romantic, but I realize he doesn't appreciate romance. Mm. So I had to go to his language. Mm. So I am very soft flower kind of person, dinner. Yeah. You know, I can sit down and I feel like doing something fine. I want fine dining.
Yeah.
And I don't see the idea. One time we went, Jesus Christ. So that is how true it is. So I'm sitting here, I'm married to a Christian man, but my temperament is so adaptive that it's okay.
Yeah.
So people don't know you have a need, but because you have swallowed it and kept it, because the Holy Spirit is guiding you, that you are different and there's a bigger picture than just always having what you want. It's about compromise and making it work. It doesn't mean don't talk about what you feel, but it took us about 7 years for him to accept that I would have to express it. However, by writing, by talking, anyhow, it has
once
to come.
Once you've expressed it.
Yes, I'm fine about that. But when it comes to sex, generally, I think that women are melancholics.
I see.
So we would act it. I would wear something new. I would buy a perfume that would draw you. So I'm drawing you by your eyes and what you see. Mm. Because that's how you hear anyway.
So temperaments play out in our sex lives.
Oh, major, major. If the Lord hasn't even touched it, for instance, for a choleric woman, you may have it once a year.
Say that again.
If the Lord has not touched a choleric woman, for instance, you may have sex once a year. Because... it's work for her. What have you done to gain that?
Can you take that?
maybe I'm not married to a choleric woman.
No, but if she were to be choleric.
She's not. So she's not. You know? And like Maureen said, I mean, these are things you learn, you know, over time. You know, and you know, once you open yourself up to learn, because I tell my wife that, look, over the period, I also realized that your feedback, okay, what we call complaints, let me use it in that expression, okay, it also helps you realize that, oh, okay, so my wife is expecting this of me, my wife is expecting that of me, and so sometimes you will say, hey, Charlie Joe, fine, you have changed.
Oh, the word of God has worked in you.
But I mean, between the two of you, who makes the advance, you know, when it comes to that the most?
I think that for that,
since for the picture you've painted is you're more creative when it comes to
very more creative. Yes. Very, very creative.
And I think my response is also very good.
I'm to say that first of all.
Because you see, if you are innovative,
yes,
in that sense,
yes,
and then your spouse is not responding,
yes,
mm,
it can sometimes kill the innovation,
yeah,
mm, more like the initiative.
Mm.
Okay, so let's say 3-4 days
mm,
I haven't gone close to my wife,
mm-hmm,
then and my wife thinks a lot.
Mm.
I always tell her that her mind works.
I'm melancholic.
Exactly. Hey, she's not dull. I mean, she's just thinking, hey, what's happening here? 4 days. This guy hasn't come around. By the time you realize she's wearing something,
mm,
once I see them, I'm like, hey, she, but this one, where you get from?
Because
you
I...
So that is more like driving you.
So you responded.
Her. And, yeah, and I also think it's exciting.
It
you
is.
Understand? Her? Because, you know, as human as we are, sometimes, I mean, you get a bit stressed out,
yeah,
you get a bit tired,
you drift,
you know,
a bit.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. So these things have a way of pulling
you
back into assignment.
I see.
You know, back into purpose.
I like that. Into assignment. So, so basically, I think that what Pastor Kojo said is very true. But one of the things I like to say is that, for instance, when we first got married, I hadn't had sex before. So I thought it was going to be over the moon.
Mm.
And then Masada, I think, was not doing the thing I thought it would do. We had to talk about it.
Mm.
But naturally, a melancholic me have compressed it. But because I was brought up to say what I felt, I had to say that, guy, the thing, it's not church,
yeah,
this one. Uh-huh. The expectation is not. We spoke about it.
I
and because
see.
He was goal-oriented, he so, you see, we have temperament. I have analyzed, I've spoken about it. He's goal-oriented, he has to achieve it.
So our temperaments play out,
oh,
in
yes,
every
oh,
facet.
It's underpins our behavior.
I see.
So
every behavioral pattern you see is as a result of the temperament of the person.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yes, basically that is it.
So for a couple who are saying that my wife does not really...
She's not exciting.
It's not exciting when it comes to our sex life.
There could be.
I mean,
factors. A number of
factors.
A lot of factors.
That one, I think we should even have a different day for that.
Yes.
Because I was telling Pastor about a week ago that I want to teach Christians how to have sex.
Give us a teaser.
Oh, no. It's very important. I'm a counselor in church and I know what I hear.
Yeah.
And the way he does it is like 92%.
The way it is done.
So the woman is not offering herself, because I'm the counselor who will tell you that your body is not yours for your husband. Offer yourself to him, yield your members to him, and please your husband, because that's what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 7:33-36. It's his body. It's not yours anymore. But now my body, you can't be treating your body the way you're treating this body. So you hold me and there is no sense of soft. There's no sense of calmness. The biao pentem. So that's why you'd say, Pastor Kojo would say that my wife likes talking during lovemaking. I talk because I need you to understand how to deal with the body. It's my body. It's our body. But now if you just come and take the body.
Nah, I thought you were shy.
I'm an extroverted introvert. I'm very shy. I'm very shy.
Goodness.
Oh, Lord, help me. I'm very shy. Yes, I am shy. Oh, jeez.
Oh, carry on.
Yeah,
carry on,
so it depends on who is there doing it. So if you come, your breath is bad because you fasted. Let's talk about Christian marriages here. So your breath is bad because you fasted. You want to kiss me every day. Master, get some mint on your way back home. Be conscious of what you're doing. You're dealing with a human body. And a human body that reacts or responds to sound, whatever it is. So if I love perfumes, and so I would buy, depending on how I feel, I can just go to a shop and buy a new one because I don't like what the other one is doing. It's not arousing my husband enough. The fact that he's a pastor doesn't mean that in the bedroom.
So you've got to be
intentional
even in the choice of your
because
fragrances.
He would not talk about it.
Mm.
So what he does is that he responds to my actions. He doesn't tell me Maureen got top perfume, no. But he responds to, if I test it and it works, I do it more.
Mm.
He won't talk about it. Oh, he'll tell me, oh, my wasa yo, but I
but
know.
Because the scripture says, be
you. He tells you wasa.
Oh,
okay, yeah. Yeah. But you know, it's okay because I'm helping him. He says it a lot, but I know he needs it for the work he does. A lot of times I tell him that some of the reasons why I don't get upset or don't, you know, I don't carry myself badly is because of what you do.
Mm.
There's so much burden on you. And so when it comes home, I'm not going to tell you because you didn't do this, because my natural disposition is that you have to earn the sex.
Yeah.
That's my melancholic side.
That's profound.
Yes.
Say that again.
You have to earn it. You can't just come and say, let's have sex. So Charles, this. I mean, my husband is not domestic. So I can't expect that from him. I don't expect that. So I carry all of that burden and I save energy. Likewise, if he's coming home, I mean, earlier in the days of Joy FM especially, he'll come home tired. Maureen, my brother, I said, Joe, you can't come home and get tired on me. Save some of the energy because I need you to be active here as well.
Mm.
But on the other hand, another pastor's wife or another Christian woman would say, oh, because it's a pastor, but he needs somebody to draw him out of that place. But because we think that, oh, you're so full, remember, say, Mehano, before you realize he's drifting, that's where we hear people listing pastors as people who are in some kind of, you know, indulging in some things in the country. Why? Because nobody drew them in that place. I say something that the anointing likes attention.
The anointing
likes attention. Likes attention. So if you have an anointed person with you, you have to attend to them daily.
Mm.
Nobody serves my husband, for instance. I want to be, because he is result-oriented, he will be driven towards that person who is giving him result. I should be the only one giving that type of result. Because honestly, so you have to draw from him, because he would not tell you do this, do that, but you have to be creative. Have Christian friends, women friends who would help you wake up. Don't be in the place where you say Yahweh, Yahweh 4, Yahweh 5. No, don't blame your weight. You can still be creative.
How do we factor children? I mean, interestingly, time isn't on us. I wish we could, you know, have a second part of this. I mean, how do we factor children into all of this? Because since we began talking about temperament, it paints a picture that it is work.
Yes. A lot of it.
It is work, and you've got to be intentional with it.
Very.
How do we factor children into all of these?
Do you mean children in terms of sex? And
in terms of raising them, you know, and ensuring, ensuring that.
The Bible says that we should train up a child in the way they should go, and when they go, they will not depart. I have three children, and all of them, okay, two are similar, one is very different.
Okay.
So because I have understanding of temperament, there are things that I don't ask her to do.
Mm.
So one of my daughters is very permissible. So she doesn't want it, but mommy, if they want it, let them do it. I said, no, Ikea, you have to tell people what you think. If they want to do it, they can do it. So that you're building in a way that you're confident in your temperament. Because I always say that if I wasn't brought up that way, the kind of pressure I receive from people to change who I am is high. So if I wasn't confident in who I am in terms of in the word of God, how I was brought up, I'll be broken by now. Because my husband is fiery. He's feisty. And so I would want to be like him, because his temperament is likable. Mine is quite not too sure. I mean, I said, hey, you know, on penny part, you know, because, you know, so I would have been very confused. How do I express to people that this is just me? I'm quite a phlegmatic. I'm quite melancholic. So I'm thinking about being perfect. So before I finish processing, you are gone. But you don't know that I was processing to know how to deal with Pastor Ato. So I don't know if I should hug him or hold him, but he can come and laugh. Oh, wow, Pastor Ato! And then he hugs you. But I have to process it. But people don't have time to listen. So I always tell him that the most confusing temperament to be in Ghana, especially, is melancholic. Because before you finish processing, they've taken judgment on you.
It's true.
And you have this feisty, sociable, lovable person. So if my father, for instance, didn't grow me in that place, be confident in who you are, and the word of God did not add the word of God to it, I'll be very miserable.
Let me bring my situation here on board.
Yes.
Just you see, Obi Apono Safwa Obi Obi dear. We are blessed with four.
Yeah. Wow.
Three boys and a girl.
Yeah.
The girl is a strong character.
Yeah.
The boys are very soft people, you know. Now, there sometimes may be the temptation, and she's not the first one. She's not a strong character because she's the first one. She's second.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. But then it's even stronger than her elder brother.
Yeah.
Now, in raising children like that, how do we apply wisdom such that they don't lose themselves, but then still ensure, guided, you know,
it's for the parents to do that. Like I said, my first daughter is a leader. My third is a leader, so there's always a clash. So daily, I tell them that you are a leader, but you cannot control everybody to be like you.
Good.
So in training them, I tell them every day in our quiet time, you are the light, shine.
Mm.
You have to shine, but you have to shine in a way that you consider others. When I'm talking to my first, when I'm talking to my second, you have to be open-hearted. You have to be honest with people. Don't be a hypocrite. So it's one scripture, but I break it down because of the
to
type
suit
of people,
their personalities.
Yeah, their personalities. So that when you see my children, they are different, but they are similar. Because it's coming from one source. Yeah. But the way
who takes after him? I'm sure the one who bears his name takes after him.
Yeah, Frimpong is a mixture of the two of us. She can she can go up and down. Yes, but she's a leader. She's very creative. I think that one, they got it from me.
I see.
All of them are very creative. But when I'm talking to them, I talk to them in a way that I understand what tomorrow may be. So don't, one is easily angered. So I talk to her a lot about 1 Corinthians 13. Love is kind. A leader must be patient. You don't have to drive people because you have that understanding. Don't be easily irritated. So we do every morning, I tell them your light shine. But remember that people are different from you. So in everything I do to them, when wash the dishes, one will go immediately, the other one would be sluggish about it. Acquah, the Bible says that if you have anything to do it now. Be diligent about it. Don't slack, be fervent. So she said, then before I say, mommy, be fervent in spirit. And we see that it changes.
Yes.
So you have to be consistent, knowing that's why parenting is one of the most important things that we have to even talk about as a nation.
Interesting.
You don't train the children as one people. No. You train them based on their disposition and how they take things.
Pastor Kojo, your take on that is.
I think I totally agree.
I just wish I could just draw the time back.
I totally agree with Maureen. And, you know, in our home, and my wife does more of the interaction with the children. You know, and these children in our days and in our time are very smart. You know, in terms of they even understanding the behavior or the behavioral pattern of their parents. You understand? Especially when they get to a certain age, they are able to predict the way their parents behave. So for instance, my first and second daughter, maybe they are helping their mother cook, then it's around 5:45. Then the first one will tell, mommy, can we speed up so daddy won't enter the kitchen when he comes?
Yeah.
What will happen when daddy enters the kitchen?
Because till today, we are 15 years in May,
yeah.
But I still get surprised that why do you have to come to the kitchen? I want to serve you because that's my disposition. It has to be done properly. But no, more. Why didn't you call me that you were coming? I want to set the table. It's not till today, we still
have dishes thing by yourself.
Something happened. He wanted more food and he got up. I said, Joe, you have 3 children. Why don't you call one? To ask
dish
them
the
to dish
the part of the meal I
that want. But for me, it surprises me. Why wouldn't you call them to do that? But you want to, because he wants to, that particular portion is what I'm looking for. So it's funny, but daily we get upset, we come out of it, and by the grace of God, we just...
Interestingly, time is into that side, but we've got to do this again. Pastor Kojo, we've got to do this again.
We've got to do this again.
We've got to do this again.
Next year.
No. We've got to do this again. You know. But I would want to take your last comments before we draw down the curtains. Yeah. Beginning with you.
So basically what I would say is that, you know, we are shaped by words. Okay. We are transformed by words. Our mindset is built on what we see and what we hear. So please ensure that you allow God's word to dominate your thinking. That is what will bring the best out of your temperament.
Wow. Yeah. Right then. It's worrying.
Yes. I'd like to say that people are different, and so we should look at people in the perspective as God sees us different. And don't judge people because you want them to behave a certain way. But give people room to express who they are, and let's all consider one another as Christ has considered us.
Right. Yes. It's been educative. It's been very inspirational. And so this is where we'd want to draw down the curtains as far as today's edition of A Walk with Jesus is concerned. I've had a power couple, you know, in the house. It's been a glorious time. I'm very sure that you have learned a lot.
I think you should ask Uncle Ken.
I definitely am going to ask Uncle Ken, you know. Definitely I'm going to ask Uncle Ken. I'm sure you have taken down some notes and you have learned a couple of things. The most important thing is to put into practice what you have learned. The Bible says that for the word did not profit them, not because the word was not efficacious, it's because they didn't mix it with faith. It means they didn't put the word to action.
Yeah.
Okay, so whatever you have learned, practice it. I'm very sure that it will enrich your home. It will make your home what it ought to be. I want to say a big thank you to Pastor and Mrs. Frimpong for being with us.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us again.
Uncle Ken.
Pastor.
How are you, sir?
I am not too bad. Thank you very much. I had to rush to come and meet Pastor.
I know, right?
I've never met him.
Oh, really? I have never met Pastor Kojo Frimpong.
So I sent this to Uncle Ken from Groove FM.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, so...
All these years.
I've been a
years.
Jazz fan many
That's years. Been how many years now from Groove FM?
Oh, it's about, this is my 24th year.
Yeah, in Joy, at Joy.
At Joy FM. Yes. So,
you know, so yeah. You can imagine.
And I've always been listening to Pastor Kojo from, especially on a Thursday night when I leave here.
Yeah.
I don't sleep till I've heard him come on.
I see.
You know, and I listen to him.
Then let me introduce you, Pastor Kojo Frimpong. Meet Uncle Ken.
Yes.
Adi, Uncle Ken,
yes.
Adi.
Yes.
Meet Pastor Kojo Frimpong.
So,
and Mrs. Frimpong.
Yes, I had to go somewhere and I had to rush to get here tonight.
Wow.
And I've been listening to them, you know, and I tell you what. There are two things I took from the conversation.
Yes.
You know, remember one day I told you here on this show that it is very, very important for couples to stay attractive to each other.
Yes. Yes.
And she said it. She said, if you are plump or if you are what they called
plus size
these days, you should still make an effort to look attractive to your husband.
Yeah. That's right.
You know. And then I realized again that there's conversation between them.
Yeah. Yeah.
They talk a lot.
Yeah.
They laugh a lot.
Yeah.
I got that from the conversation this evening, and it's so crucial to a successful marriage life.
That's true.
I'm so happy.
That's true. Thank you very much, Uncle Ken. What do we have on Jazz on Joy tonight?
Oh, the usual, you know, just lovely jazz to help you through the night.
Right.
Get you ready for work.
Exactly.
Tomorrow.
Exactly. Wow. Exactly. I've been enjoying the African tunes.
I played a song for you the last time.
Ah.
I played your favorite Richard Bona.
Richard Bona song.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So we'll keep listening, Uncle Ken.
Nice one.
Enjoy your show. This is where we draw down the curtains. Many thanks to Michaela. And God richly bless you. We're out of here.